Hello everybody, welcome to Campus Tutorial. I am Arindam, hope you are doing well. And today I am going to discuss about Hammett equation. And you know that I have already uploaded videos on Hammond principle and Cartin-Hammett principle. So these two things have already been discussed over there. You can just find the link in the description box. You can check in the description box below. And in this lecture, I will cover the basic of the Hammett equation. And what are the fundamental topics, what is the background of this equation, why we will just learn this equation, and what are the basic applications, we will learn about that. And in the next video, I will discuss some previous year's questions as well along with. So this is going to be a very useful video. So I will suggest you to watch my video till the end. And if you are new to my channel, then of course hit the subscribe button and the bell icon as well, so that you can get the notification of my latest videos at the earliest. So without a further ado, let's get started. Okay, so let's begin with our basic principle of the Hammett equation. So first of all, we need to know that what is the utility of Hammett equation. So if you see that this equation is basically used to quantify, it is used to quantify the effect of electron donating group or electron withdrawing group to the transition state or to the intermediate. So this is something what we are getting, that what is the effect of electron donating group or electron withdrawing group on the transition state or on the intermediate. So that is what we are going to discuss in this video, and this is the basic of the Hammett equation. Okay, see, when Hammett just framed this equation, at that time the advancement of science was not like today. So there he actually tried to just understand what is the reaction mechanism and how the reaction mechanism can be just governed by this kind of electronic effects. So that is something which was his ultimate goal. So in order to find this kind of relationship with the reaction mechanism, he just picked up a very simple example of the hydrolysis of ester. So you can see it is a ester, okay? And basically the basic hydrolysis, he is performing basic hydrolysis. So you know that today it is quite easier for you to draw this kind of mechanism over here. So it will attack in this case. Now it will be O minus. It will come back, and this OR dot minus, this will be just removed from the system as a leaving group. So this is what you are actually getting. Okay. So this will be OH and R dot O minus. And since this is more acidic, so it is readily just transferring H plus to this, so it is basically forming O minus and R dot OH. So this is what you are getting from the basic hydrolysis of any kind of ester. It could be aliphatic ester, it could be aromatic ester. So see, what you can see that this reaction has some rate constant. Suppose the rate constant is small k, okay? So this is denoted as a small k. Now what Hammett actually focused over here in this portion, this is basically forming a carboxylic acid. And this carboxylic acid, you can see that this carboxylic acid is just forming its conjugate base. Okay, so in the course of this reaction, if you carefully see, this is the carboxylic acid, and it is thereby forming its conjugate base. So you can see that it is comparable to this kind of ionization. So over here, this is equilibrium state, because you know that carboxylic acids are not strong acid, so they will be just ionized in this following manner. Now if you just compare the dissociation constant of this acid, it will be something Ka, and from here you know that the value of the pK, which is basically minus log of Ka, so it actually gives the idea about the acidic strength of any molecule, of any carboxylic acid. So you can say that acidity is inversely proportional to the pKa value. So if pKa value is lesser, then automatically acidity will be higher. Now when Hammett was investigating this equation, he just saw that here it is a rate constant and it is the dissociation constant of the acid which is basically forming over here. So he tried to draw a relationship between them, and that is what he was trying. It was just a trial and error method for him. If you see that, he just plotted something like that. Okay, so this is something where in this y-axis he just took log of k, which is basically the rate constant, and in this x-axis he plotted the pKa values, okay, pKa values of that acid what is forming after the reaction. This k basically the rate constant, it is the rate constant for carboxylates. Okay, so this is the rate constant for the carboxylate. And this pKa of the acid formed, okay, after the base hydrolysis of any carboxylate, carboxylic acid is forming. So what is the value of the pKa? So now he tried to plot it, plot a graph over there, and what he has got, something like this. Well, from this plot, it is quite inconclusive because you are getting some random points. You can't imagine any graph, okay, any line or any curve from here. So it is quite inconclusive because what is the meaning of this plot? If you see that, suppose this actually represents different substrates. Suppose you are talking about this point. This point suggests that this is, if you just follow this one, this is the pKa of the acid which is forming. Suppose in this reaction, this is the ester. Okay. So you can see that it is a methyl acetate over here. And it is basically forming CH3COOH. After the end of the reaction, it is forming something like that. So what you actually see that this point correspond to the pKa. Suppose this is the pKa of this acid. Okay. And you can see if you investigate the rate constant and then take the log of that, so you will find something like that. It is the value of this log K. So you are getting a point related to this one. So this is of your, suppose, this ester. This point, this highlighted point is basically this ester. Suppose now you are taking this point. Okay, now you find that this is a pKa value, and suppose this pKa value is something like your CH3CH2COOOME. And from here what you are getting, CH3CH2COO-, okay, and MeOH, whatever, this is a byproduct. So this is basically the acid, conjugate base of the acid. So basically it has a acid like that. It is basically the propanoic acid, and it is a pKa of the propanoic acid. And if you investigate the rate constant of this hydrolysis reaction, you will find this is a log K. So K is the rate constant, and you will find this point. So this is how he actually plotted this graph, and he was trying to build some relationship from here. So now he is trying to investigate that what are these plots. So when he just paid a closer attention to this, so what he found, that suppose this part in this above region, okay, in this above part, if you see this region, so he found that whatever the points are present in this region, this is basically the points related to the, if you see the pKa values and the rate constant, so these are for your aliphatic esters. These are for your aliphatic esters. So this R, C, O, O, R, okay, O, R dot, this is the ester, aliphatic ester. Over here, this R group is the aliphatic group. Now, except this region, all of the plots below this region, I mean, these all plots are basically corresponding to the aromatic ester, okay. Now, one interesting feature he observed from here, he just took these plots from this region. So when he took plot from this region, So he found that this is the region where he is getting the ortho substituted aromatic ester. Aromatic esters. Suppose he took a ester over here and it is an aromatic ring, okay, and some group is present, suppose nitro group is present in the ortho position. So this is the structure of the aromatic esters over this region. Now what he found, that when he excluded all of these plots, okay, all of these plots, when he excluded, he found that this is something where a straight line can be just formed in this region. And interestingly, this region actually corresponds to the, this region is basically, this region corresponds to the, suppose this is the region what I am showing over here, that this region contains aromatic meta and para substituted, okay, all the aromatic esters, these are also aromatic esters, but they are actually meta or para substituted aromatic esters, not the ortho substituted aromatic ester. So now if you just pay a closer attention to this graph with this middle region, you can easily draw a line over here. Okay, you can find it, that a straight line you can see. And this is the most important finding, okay, what he has done from here. He said that there is a one possible explanation with this, that for aliphatic ester, this group is the aliphatic group over here, the group which is present is the aliphatic group. And you know that in aliphatic system, there is the free bond rotation and they can adopt different conformations. Okay, so different conformations can be obtained, and that is why it is to some extent interfering the reaction. And in case of the ortho, this could be one possible reason, that this ortho substituted group is creating some steric hindrance with the ester center, which is basically the reactive center. So this can hamper the reaction rate, and that is why you cannot get any proper conclusion over there. Those plots are completely random. But in this case, in this middle region, you can find that this is the middle region, and this region corresponds to the aromatic esters, which are basically meta or para substituted. Now from this observation, what is the conclusion? That this Hammett equation, it is valid only for meta or para substituted aromatic esters. Okay, now if you just take a look at this plot, you can see that over here the pK is plotted in the x-axis, and it is quite difficult to just remember all the pKa values of different kinds of acid. So what he was trying to just introduce some new parameter, and over here a new parameter is introduced, that is called the sigma parameter, which is basically the Hammett substituent constant. This sigma, basically Hammett substituent constant. Now what is the expression for this sigma? Sigma actually represents log of Ka of meta or para substituted benzoic acid, okay, meta or para substituted benzoic acid, minus log of Ka of the benzoic acid. So now he is taking benzoic acid as the reference and the other meta or para substituted benzoic acids, and he is just comparing the Ka values of the log of Ka values. So this is what you are getting from here. Now you know that minus log Ka is basically the pKa. So suppose in this first case, you can take minus of minus log Ka of, suppose I am just writing substituted benzoic acid. Okay, it is obviously it is meta or para substituted. So substituted benzoic acid, and minus of log Ka of simple benzoic acid. From here you can see that this is the minus log of K, so it is basically the pK. So it is basically minus pKa of substituted benzoic acid, and this is the minus pKa, minus log Ka of benzoic acid, so it is basically plus pKa of benzoic acid. So from here you can see that the pKa of benzoic acid minus pKa of substituted benzoic acid. So this is what you can call the Hammett substituent constant sigma. Now over here the benzoic acid has a pKa value of 4.2. So the expression is something like this, minus pKa Sp. Okay, that means the substituted benzoic acid. So this is what you are getting from here. And just I am highlighting this expression, this is quite important. Okay, from here what I can see that the sigma value is basically the 4.2 minus pKa of substituted benzoic acid. Now rather instead of 4.2, if I write this is the pKa of the simple benzoic acid and it is the pKa of the substituted benzoic acid. Now we can say that if any substituted benzoic acid is more acidic than normal benzoic acid. So what you can see, in that case pKa of the substituted benzoic acid will be lower than the pKa of the benzoic acid. Okay, so for this case this substituted benzoic acid, this pKa will be lower, and that is why you will get a positive value. Now when you will get positive value, suppose this is the benzoic acid. Now suppose you are taking some group in the para position and it is your electron withdrawing group NO2. So what you can see that this electron withdrawing group, it is basically minus I as well as minus R effect is exerting, and minus I is weak because it is para substituent. So you have to consider the minus R effect, and you can see that it is due to the minus R effect. If you consider the stability of the conjugate base, it is from your basic GOC concept. So this is the conjugate base if you abstract the hydrogen. So now you can see that this is just pulling electron density towards itself. So it is basically stabilizing the conjugate base. So if you compare the acidity between the benzoic acid and paranitrobenzoic acid, paranitrobenzoic acid is more acidic. So if the acidity of this substituted benzoic acid is greater, then obviously the pKa value will be lower. So in this case, if you compare the sigma value, okay, so suppose you are taking an ester, suppose you are taking an ester of this one, and you are doing our initial hydrolysis, base hydrolysis, so you are getting something like this, okay. So this is what we are discussing. Now you are just considering the pKa value. So you find that this pKa value of this substituted benzoic acid, it is lower as compared to the pKa value of the benzoic acid. So in this case, for this reaction, the Hammett substituent constant sigma, this sigma value will be positive. Okay, so this is what you are getting. Now you can say that if electron withdrawing group is present in the substituent, and this substitution can be present either in meta substitution or the para substitution. So electron withdrawing group will increase the acidity and thereby lowering the pKa value. On contrary, if any substituted benzoic acid is less acidic than simple benzoic acid, you can see that then the pKa of the substituted benzoic acid will be greater as compared to the pKa of the benzoic acid. So this will be happening when there will be electron donating group either in meta or para substitution. So in this case, what you can see, for this case the pKa value of the benzoic acid is lower. So in this case, what you will get, you will get the sigma value will be negative. So this is the basic conclusion what you can draw from here. Now I am going to give you the example that suppose you are taking substituent, different substituent over here, and you are considering the sigma value of para substituted and the meta substituted. So suppose a substituent is NH2. Now you know that this NH2 is minus I and plus R group. So when it is present in the para position, minus I is not that much effective. So plus R effect, that means it is the electron donating group, and electron donating group, you can see that electron donating group drives the negative value of the sigma. So the sigma P, when it is present in the para position, plus R effect is more important. So for this case, the sigma P value will be negative and it will be minus 0.62. And when it is present in the meta position, experimentally you will see that it is around 0. So there is not much difference between the pKa of the substituted benzoic acid and the benzoic acid itself. So it is quite similar to this one. Now suppose a substitution is methoxy. For this case, it is also a minus I and plus R. And when it is present in the para position of the benzoic acid, so it will be acting as a electron donating group. So now you can see it has a value minus 0.29. And now what happens if it is present in the meta position? See, when this methoxy is present in the meta position, it is exerting the minus I effect but not the plus R, because in meta position resonance is not that much effective. So what you can see, that negative conjugate base is stabilized by the minus I effect. So now the sigma M value will be positive. So it will be 0.11. So this is what you are getting. Now suppose you are taking fluorine. Okay, this fluorine, you can see that when this fluorine or halogen attaches to the benzene ring, so it is basically exerting the minus I effect and not the resonance. So for this case, minus I effect means electron withdrawing group. Now electron withdrawing group, if it is present in the para position, okay, suppose you are considering the benzoic acid, okay, and in the para position there is fluorine. So it will be showing minus I effect, but this minus I effect is very poor. So although it is the electron withdrawing effect, minus I effect means electron withdrawing effect. So you can see that this is the positive value for the electron withdrawing group. So the value will be positive, but it will be a very less positive value, so 0.05. Now when this group is present in the meta position, that means the meta substituent, you can find it out that now the minus I effect is quite stronger. So now the sigma M, this value will be a higher positive value, so it will be 0.34, plus 0.34. This is how you are calculating the sigma values. Now I am giving you the examples of some other groups as well. Like for other halogens, for your iodine, chlorine and bromine, the values are something like this: 0.23, 0.22, 0.23. And over here it is 0.35, 0.37 and 0.4. Now remember that these values are not important. You need not remember the value, but you have to get a clear-cut idea about why it is positive and why it is negative. The question can be framed from here. And there could be some numerical problems as well from this equation, which is the sigma. What is the value of the sigma? They can ask. You can get the pKa value of the benzoic acid as well as the pKa value of the substituted benzoic acid. So this is what you are getting. So this is the basic of the Hammett equation. Now in the next class, I will discuss about another parameter, which is called the rho. Okay, and rho is called the reaction constant. In the next class, I will discuss about the reaction constant, and most of the question is framed from the reaction constant. But before going to discuss reaction constant, we have already learned that where this Hammett equation actually is forming and what is the utility of different kind of the different kind of substituent, and how you can find out the Hammett constant, Hammett substitution constant. So these are the basic foundation which I have discussed over here. In the next class, I will be discussing about the rho and some previous years questions where you can find the question from your GATE as well as NET. So stay tuned. If you like the video, don't forget to share and subscribe. Thank you. Happy learning.